I need only say that the Prime Minister made quite fundamental statements in her contribution to the budget debate, and I look forward to our being guided by those statements as we examine the matters under the particular head that's before us now. Thank you very much.
All right, honorable members, the question is that the sum of $638,708,600 for Head 13, the Office of the Prime Minister, stand part of the schedule. Honorable members, the sum of $638,708,600 for Head 13, the Office of the Prime Minister, is comprised of monies proposed for expenditure under the following subheads and items to be found in the draft estimates of recurrent expenditure and the draft estimates of development program. Subhead 1, personal expenditure. Item 1, general administration. I recognize member for Digo Martin Central.
If there are no other contributions. Chairman, I just have an inquiry on salaries and cost of living allowance decreasing over the period, inclusive of the 2015 estimate, but the NIS contributions remaining the same. How can we account for that? I also want to ask about this cabinet-appointed committee. Which committee are we referring to with respect to this remuneration? I also want to ask about the vacant posts that are indicated here. 6 million was projected in 2014 and 3 million for 2015. Not a cent has been expended thus far. What is the explanation for this?
Acting Prime Minister.
The accounting officer, Mr. Reynold Cooper, would assist with these questions. Yeah. He is more familiar than all of us, I'm sure.
Would you like the permanent secretary to speak?
The Prime Minister related.
All right. Okay, all right, okay.
Insofar as the increased salaries and cost of living allowance bill is concerned, members would be aware, Chair, that the Salaries Review Commission had made certain adjustments, and these numbers are carried in 2014 estimates. Yeah? And the
no, but that doesn't, I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, but just to help speed the process, that doesn't respond. I appreciate the response. It doesn't respond to my question, though. Salaries have decreased by $2 million, salaries and COLA, but the NIS contributions remain the same. I just wanted to know if the acting Prime Minister can explain that observation in addition to
salaries. In 2013, you are looking at 14 million.
Acting Prime Minister, if you look at the right-hand column, That indicates the net increase or decrease in brackets.
Yes.
And there's 1,970,600 in brackets, which means there's a decrease.
That's this year.
Yeah, but you see, this year, it's changing from here.
Chair, that, well, of course, we accept that NIS would not have changed, yes? But this number, 16,650,000, includes retroactive payment, which would have been earned earlier, yes? So in 2015, we would have gone back to a number that is without such retroactivity. That committee is, that is the CLECO and HCU commissioners, yes? They would have being remunerated in the sums indicated here.
No, I think he's asking for more.
Chair, just for clarification.
Wait, before you go to clarification, I think that the member on the Gumatin Central is sorry for.
No, he's on this point with the
I'm on the same committee. Same
that's the committee.
Okay. You deal with item
01. Okay. Cabinet appointed committee.
Okay.
Right.
Which sub item again?
Well, 01. Third line. There's no corresponding number to it. Remuneration to members.
On what page? Page
51. On page 51, sir.
51. We're not on page 51. We're on page 52. We deal with personal administration.
Okay, same thing under cabinet appointed committee.
Number.
14. Sorry.
Right.
14.
Mm-hmm.
The acting prime minister just said this was to pay commissioners into the HCO and CLECO.
Yeah.
I wish to correct that.
Thank you.
I wish to correct that. It would have been the National Awards Committee the Sport and Culture Fund Board.
That's
member for Diego Martin Central.
Yes, the vacant post.
Vacant post.
Vacant posts.
I thought they were
08
to this thing.
A 08.
Would you repeat your question,
please?
Yes.
Could you repeat?
No, I'm looking in the summary of expenditure on this issue. And there was 6 million estimated for 2014 under OPM. And none was expended. And there's 3 million estimated for this year. Am I seeing correctly? And I was seeking an explanation from the Prime Minister.
Yes.
Did you get that?
There's no vacant post filled. There's one filled in 2014. Vacant post filled in 2014. There's none. There's a provision put for the vacant post.
Yeah. I take offense to that. I take very serious offense to that. Yeah? And I wish that you would have some respect.
Yes.
Chairman,
I am not sure where we at because I'm a little bit lost. Could you just guide me back to where we are, Mr. Speaker?
We have one personal expenditure, item one, general administration.
And what are we pursuing?
Some item 8-08, vacant posts, salaries and COLA.
Yeah, Mr. Cooper. We did not use the sum of 1,300,000 there, right?
It's five million.
Mm-hmm. And for 2015, we are providing a sum of 3 million. Yes? But we did not use that which was estimated 5 million in 2014. We have not used it.
Mr. Chair, what will trigger providing 3 million for 2015 if, you know, you had no usage for the 5 million in 2014? What will inform that figure, please?
You have vacant posts. So you have to provide again that the service can hire people.
Yeah. I'm advised, sir, that if the service commission were to hire persons in those vacant posts, we have provided for such hiring.
Okay, we go to subhead 02, goods and services. Item one, general administration. Member for the Gumatin West.
Mr. Chairman.
Aruka Maloney, and then Labre. You member for the Gumatin West?
Mr. Chairman, I'll have my first comment at subhead 16, so if there are comments,
okay.
I'll wait.
All right. Aruka Maloney?
Yes, Mr. Chair, I have several questions coming under this particular subhead. With reference to contract employment, yes. There has been an observation of a gradual increase in the allocation. I would like to know how many contract positions exist. Exactly whether or not all vacancies are filled and whether new positions were created during the period 2014 to 2015. Under fees, that's
one at a time, let's take one at a time. Can Prime Minister say it?
Contract positions.
Yes.
Number 148. New positions. Communications unit. How many positions in there? 15.
Yes.
Mr. Chair, he didn't respond to how many, the new positions. Sorry, Mr. Chair. I just want to go on to fees.
Yes.
If they can provide us with a breakdown of the fees that actually would be, are expected to be paid under the allocation. We see here 10 million has been allocated, Mr. Speaker. Even though there is a decrease of 4 million, we would like to find out about the decrease and to find out about the breakdown with reference to the fees that has to be paid.
We will return with such information.
Yes, Member for the Gumatin.
As I said, Mr. Chairman, I would like to come in at number 16, contract employment.
Right.
Yeah. Subhead 16.
Right.
Sub 16. Contract employment. I observe, Mr. Chairman, that we're making a provision of $13 million for contract employment in this ministry, which is larger than the allocation for the establishment. Because if we look at 00101 under general administration, we see that the provision for the establishment of the Prime Minister's office is 12.68 million. But we see a provision of 13 million for contract officers. And there has been a consistent growth in contract employment in this ministry from 9 million in 2013 to 10 million in 2014. And we're making a provision of 13 million for 2015. And I would like to ask the Prime Minister, what is the cause of this growth of contract employment in the Prime Minister's office, where it has now superseded the establishment? And what is the procedure used to select persons for these positions, and who determines the emoluments to be paid, the level of emoluments and so on? Who determines that? Who established what these people are paid? And also, we would like to get a complete list of all the persons hired in the Prime Minister's office with respect to these contract positions and their terms of engagement. And Mr. Chairman, I would like us to conclude the subhead of 16 before, as we did this morning, we finish one item before we go on to the other one, otherwise we get confused.
Yeah.
So I wait my answers on 16 before I proceed.
Okay. Prime Minister?
Yes. The CPO sets the terms and conditions of employment, right? Mm-hmm. Any listing of the persons contracted would come later, Chair. We are going to provide that information.
Can we expect that before we finish the examination of the budget on day five?
Again for the persons?
Yeah.
Thank you. And what about the procedure for, before I do that, is the Prime Minister telling us that all the persons employed by the Prime Minister's office and who are being paid there now, that their terms have been set by the CPO? That's what I heard.
Well,
he said the terms are set by the CPO. I'm asking, is that a definitive statement?
Contract positions will carry terms and conditions which are determined by the CPO and accepted by the particular minister.
Is there any person in the Prime Minister's office who is now being paid by the Prime Minister's office whose terms have not been set by the CPO?
I couldn't answer that
Would you undertake to check that for us, please?
Yeah.
Thank you. And with respect to how persons are selected, could you give us an idea as to how these persons are selected to fill these contract positions?
Yeah. We would normally advertise, and we would examine such applicants as fit the bill that we are seeking to fill.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to proceed to sub 19, official entertainment. And to be able to do that, Mr. Chairman, I happen to know that the approximate expenditure on official entertainment at the Prime Minister's office in the not-too-distant past was in the order of $5 million, $5.5 million. In fact, in 2010, that figure was $5.5 million. And I see a substantial provision being made now for official entertainment. It has grown from $5 million to $7.6 million in 2013, $9 million in 2014, and we are making another provision for $9 million. This is, Mr. Chairman, almost 100% increase. I would say approximately four, you know. It's a significant increase, almost a doubling of the cost in a time when we are supposed to be in some modicum of austerity. And as I asked the Ministry of Finance this morning, is there any inclination of an intention anywhere in the government to curb expenditure, or is it just general increases across the board? Because official entertainment has grown in the Prime Minister's office from 5.5 million to 9 million, leveling out on a repeat of that. So I would like to hear from the Prime Minister what exactly is driving this high entertainment cost at the Prime Minister's office.
I'm sure that we can investigate this and bring the details, but I am also very certain that we have been celebrating all of our national festivals and important occasions, contrary to what would have pertained before 2010.
Mr. Chairman, so we'll get a breakdown of the expenditure for 2014 and the proposals for 2015 to justify the request for $9 million.
Yes.
And we move on to 22, short-term employment. So we have a provision for contract employment of $13 million. But over and above that, on the subhead 22, we have another provision of $4 million for short-term employment. What exactly does short-term employment mean in this situation? And who is to be hired under that short-term employment requiring that $4 million? And how do you proceed to obtain those persons to be placed in that position?
There is a note here which says short-term or revolving employment in specific government departments and agencies where each employee's term does not exceed 6 months. Yeah?
I know that, but the question
and
I'm asking...
before contracts are approved, yeah, some persons are taken on short-term before contracts are approved.
What I'm asking is specific to the Prime Minister's office. Who are these people that you're hiring on short term where you require $4 million to hire them? What do they do? Who are these people?
Mr. Cooper?
And while I'm on that, Mr. Chairman, with respect to the contracted officers from the $13 billion, how many of those persons are working for the Voice newspaper, part-time or full-time?
I don't know that any one of us could answer that question.
Well, maybe you should, because we are on the record here, Mr. Chairman, and I'm asking, is there anybody in the Prime Minister's office who is on the state's payroll who has any involvement in the production of the Voice newspaper?
As far as I am aware, no.
I think Member for Digo Martin Central wanted to raise a point, and then Member for... You wanted to raise a point? Yes? You can now speak. And then Member for Port of Spain South.
Just a clarification. It's a sub-item that is coming up time and time again. I just want to know what house rates are. Maybe you could just clarify.
Yeah,
we've seen it under finance as well.
That is 07. You just identify these.
House rates, yeah. There's a note that says all house rates due on government properties and payable to city and borough corporations.
Honorable member, these things are all detailed in the front. So if you go to the front of the document, you'll see what these things mean, rather than there are many other matters that we can deal with that are more pressing than matters that are already published in the document.
I appreciate the explanation. Thank you.
Yes. Yes, Port of Spain South?
Yes, on item 23, fees.
Yes. Fees?
Yes, that $10 million.
Yes.
There's no explanation for it. Could the Honorable Prime Minister give me an explanation as to that $10 million? Exactly what is it about?
Fees, Honorable Prime Minister.
Mr. Chairman, while the Prime Minister...
Yes, I'm a member for Diego Martin West.
While the Prime Minister is considering that answer, I would like to join that question with respect to the root of this expenditure. And I observed that in 2013, the Prime Minister's office expended $30 million in fees. Then a further $14 million in 2014, and now a provision being made of $10 million. And if we go, Mr. Chairman, to page Roman 13, under the explanation for what fees are. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Roman 13, at the front of the document, right. Item 23, right. Fees. And my understanding as here, fees are sequestering of jurors, prison chaplain, jury fees, slaughtering fees, funeral expenses for unclaimed bodies, examination fees, audit fees, legal fees, brokerage fees, licensing and antivirus agreement. Now, those are the categories of activities or similar kind of thing that cover fees. I would like the Prime Minister to tell us, what did the Prime Minister's office spend $30 million on? In 2013, coming forward, and a further $24 million later, including a $10 million for 2015. What exactly did you pay for here?
You want to know whether it's slaughtering, whatnot, whatnot.
Prime Minister?
Yes. I'm advised that they involve legal fees for the commissions of inquiry into CLECO, HCU, and the 1990 coup attempt.
But again, is the Prime Minister aware that we have been told from another department in the government that those fees were payable from that department, namely the Attorney General's office, where significant increases, which we'll come to later on, we've appropriated over $100 million to the Attorney General's office to cover fees. There are two categories of fees in that ministry. And we were led to believe that those, as mentioned by the Prime Minister a moment ago, payment for commission of inquiries and legal arrangements were being paid for under those allocations. Because, excuse me, when we challenged the AG's office with respect to the growth in the expenditure, we were told that the main driving component was commission of inquiry. Are we now hearing that there were two sources of payment to lawyers for the commissions of inquiry, whichever they were, and namely the CLECO inquiry? And then I will ask, why are fees being paid for the CLECO inquiry out of the Prime Minister's office and not the AG's office? And I'd like to ask that of the Ministry of Finance, but we're talking to the Prime Minister's office now.
Yeah. All right. Commissions of inquiry, Chair, would normally come under the office of the Prime Minister.
In which case, I will then ask another question. Why then were we being told that the increase in the office of the Attorney General, but we'll come to that later on.
Yeah.
But of course, Mr. Speaker, we'd like to ask two things. A list of what we spent in 2014, who got those monies, what they were paid for, what we received for those payments, and what do we anticipate to be expended in 2015, and on what?
Member for Liberty.
Yeah, item 31, expenses of Prime Minister's establishment. Can we get a breakdown?
All right, just hold on, we're coming back to that. We haven't reached that one yet.
What?
We have some issues on item 27, official overseas travel. Mr. Chairman, again, I want to draw to the attention of the Ministry of Finance by way of the Prime Minister's office. Now, we are operating a budget that has a multi-billion dollar deficit, and we are not seeing any attempt to curb expenses which ought to and can be curbed. Mr. Chairman, I make this against the background where overseas travel in 2008 was $2.2 million. 2010, $3.5 million. 2013, $2.4 million in the Prime Minister's office. And this is just the Prime Minister's office overseas travel, eh? 2013, $2.4 million. 2014, $5.8 million. They budgeted $6.5 million, but couldn't manage to get the planes in time. So the spending was $5.8 million. So the Ministry of Finance budgeted $6 million in 2015. So even though $6.5 million was budgeted in 2014, and we couldn't manage to get more than $5.8 million spent in a period of required austerity, we budgeted $6 million for overseas travel in the Prime Minister's office. I think this represents an attitude where nobody's paying attention to the fact at the Ministry of Finance that we are spending more than we are earning. And there are areas that require curbing, and these kinds of expenses can be curbed without damaging the people's interests. And therefore,
go ahead. Are you true?
So I'm asking the Ministry of Finance, asking the Prime Minister's office, whether the office of the Prime Minister is prepared to curb this expenditure in this budget.
Chairman, just if I could indulge on. I just want to be very clear, Chairman, from you, to be very clear that this process we are engaged in is a process of posing questions based on the estimates before us. Or is it a process where members are allowed to make observations, inference, political statements? Because if the latter holds, members on this side of the House are quite prepared to enter into this conversation. I was of the impression, and those of us on this side, that this process is used to ask pointed questions on the estimates and subheadings before us. If members are going to make political commentary, the government is prepared to participate in that as well.
Please do. Mr. Chairman, I specifically ask the ministry, the Prime Minister, whether his ministry is prepared to curb this expense against the background of what I demonstrated is the growth of the expenditure over a period of time. And all my references, Mr. Chairman, are from the documents in front of me, the budget documents. So with all due respect to my colleagues, I have not strayed from the budget documents. The budgetary process, as I understand it, is a request for more money. And the office of the Prime Minister is asking for $6 million for overseas travel for that office. And I'm asking the Prime Minister whether, in the context of what it has been before and where it has gone, whether we cannot restrain that expenditure a bit in 2015.
Prime Minister.
Chair, I wish to assure this Honorable House that this government is committed to running the business of government as cost-effectively as possible.
All right. We're going on to I think Libre has a point that you'd like to raise.
Yes. Item 31?
Yes.
Expenses of Prime Minister's establishments, $24 million in 2010. Can we get a breakdown of that figure?
20 when?
$24 million in 2014.
The 2014 estimate and 2015.
And 2015, yeah.
No, it's 2014 you're asking.
Yeah.
The estimate.
What are you asking?
For a breakdown of the $24 million for the estimate in 2015.
Prime Minister, a breakdown of the estimates?
Yes.
For 2015? For the establishment.
2014.
Okay. No, 2014, 2015, no?
Yeah, we've taken note of the question and we will investigate it and provide as much information as we can.
Okay. All right, yes?
Before we move on from 31.
Okay.
The documents in front of us indicate that the expenses of the Prime Minister's establishment leveling out at $24 million a year. Could the Prime Minister tell us exactly what is covered by that $24 million on the household?
Well,
and
just
if any of that expenditure relates to the Prime Minister's activities outside of the Prime Minister's household at St. Anne's.
Two households she has.
Are we going to get...
No, well, I'm waiting on the Prime Minister.
No. No, yes. The number that we have there does not include anything outside of the Prime Minister's household.
All right, well...
Mr. Chairman...
Yes. Well, you have asked that they give you a breakdown.
That was the question I was asking is whether any of this expenditure relates to the Prime Minister's occupancy of anything outside of St. Anne's.
Yeah, and he said no. That is what the Prime Minister said, no.
It is listed, no, you see, I have to be very clear what question I ask and what answer I get.
Okay.
We are talking about the Prime Minister's establishment.
Right.
And he said it doesn't involve anything outside the Prime Minister's household. Okay. I'm asking household geographically outside of St. Anne's. I didn't get an answer to that.
All right, Prime Minister.
It does not involve anything outside of the Prime Minister's establishment, which I understand to be the household at St. Anne's.
All right.
Mr. Speaker, under 65, expenses of cabinet-appointed bodies.
65.
Sub 65.
Right.
Specific subhead 65. I was a little surprised a moment ago when I raised the issue of fees and the government, in attempting to explain the allocation for fees in the Prime Minister's office, told us that fees under sub 23 is for payment of the CLECO Commission of Inquiry, when in fact we have a specific subhead of 65 specific to Commission of Inquiry. Are we double counting or were we misled under 23? Could the government review this now and tell us whether that answer to 23 was a correct answer?
65.
Yes. Yes, the Prime Minister will respond. Yeah.
23 is fees for law. 65 is staff, 23 is fees for law.
I'm advised, Chair, that this number deals with staff. Yes?
Which number?
65.
65.
23
fees. And 23 is fees, essentially, for counsel and so on.
Mr. Chairman, I think I understand the English language very clearly. Under 65 sub, it says expenses of cabinet-appointed bodies. And if you go to the explanation section, you would see 65 Roman 3, and it says expenses of commissions of inquiry, $5 million.
Yes.
What are you being told about staff in this matter? It is either that money is expended in the context of payment to a commission of inquiry. Mm-hmm. That's how I understand that. But we were told early on, under 23, that the $10 million had to do with payment for the CLECO inquiry. I don't know, or maybe I should ask, did the Prime Minister's office take on staff in the context of the CLECO inquiry? Because if the answer is no, then what we've been told here cannot be correct.
But if we read further, Chair, we will see that expenses of cabinet-appointed bodies involve all expenses other than remuneration of committees, secretariats, and other such bodies appointed by cabinet for specific purposes.
So what does that mean? The question remains unanswered, because we're being told that 23 and 65, one with $10 million, one with $100 million, and they both relate to payments for commission of inquiry. Could someone clarify that? Could the Prime Minister clarify that for us? Because that, to me, Mr. Chairman, requires clarification.
But even so, Chair, yes?
Yes.
At 23, we have, what, $10 million? Mm-hmm. And the explanation at 65 talks to $5 million for commissions of inquiry.
So we have 10 on one hand and 5 on the other hand. And what I'm asking is, why is the Ministry of Finance providing two sets of monies in the same subhead for the same purpose, if we are to believe what they're telling us?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
View, and I would like to hold it out to the government that there might have been an error with respect to the answer of 23. Because it cannot be in the budgeting process that the Ministry of Finance would make $10 million available in line 23 and then make $5 million available in line 65 for the same purpose.
That's duplication.
I'd rather think that there was an error in the answer under 23.
And Chair, if you check on 09, line 09, you'll see remuneration to chairman and members of commissions of inquiry. Yes?
Where's 09?
Personal expenditure.
Under personal expenditure.
Rent and lease.
No, personal expenditure.
Under personal expenditure.
52.
No, we
are on page 52. No. Turn to page 52. Under 0109. Okay. So this just further complicates the issue. Because that means that there are three places in the Prime Minister's office with money for commission of inquiry. So no wonder we have this money, so we're looking for inquiries now.
Mr. Chair, can I ask a question? Under the new standing orders, and to use can we request that the PS answer a question? Is the PS required?
If you minister allows him.
Okay.
If you minister allows.
Mr. Chairman, could I just
ask
a question? This.
Yeah.
I gather from what is being said that under personnel 09, you pay the commissioners. Under goods and services.
The mortal will always put you in trouble.
Whichever one it was, the one with the 10 million, that is 23, you pay the lawyers. And under 65, you pay for the building. With the staff, they put the palantypist, the secretary. So you have the expenses for these things built up in three different places. Is that what's going on, Mr. Prime Minister? Commissioners one way, lawyers the next way, and secretarial and support staff the third way. That's what's going on?
Dealing with what is before us.
The answer is yes. But I'm not hearing you, Mr. Prime Minister.
Yes.
Your PS is saying yes, but I'm not hearing you.
Yes. Could we proceed? I think that you have clarified the issue.
So I've taken the yes from the permanent secretary then. No problem. I'll take the yes from the permanent secretary.
Yes. Any further clarification on?
I'm still on 65.
Still on 65?
Yeah. Sub 65.
Mm-hmm.
Which contains under Roman 1 the explanations that $93 million of that $100 million is for the National Security Council.
Yes.
Again, Mr. Chairman, I have to express my concern about the growth of public expenditure in this way. Because in 2010, that National Security Council was really using up $55 million. In 2014, we budgeted $116 million for the National Security Council, from 55 to 116. We now revised the 2014 estimates, and we revised it downwards to $80 million. What then is the justification for budgeting $100 million or $90 million in 2015? Are we guided by the actual numbers of 2014 and by What has happened in National Security Council, which is an administrative body as far as I'm aware? What has happened there to cause the budget to have grown in that way in this period of difficulty?
Prime Minister?
Chair, the National Security Council is not as slight as is being made out. Yes, it is a most important Security Council, and we would have included administrative expenses. Yeah, we would have certain intelligence issues and so on. Yeah, it involves the acquisition of important equipment, specialist training of persons and so on. Chair, I don't know, and I stand to be corrected.
Please listen.
I stand to be corrected.
Please.
I don't know that national security issues are issues that should be so glibly discussed and so on, only perhaps to score political points. I am not going to be drawn into that at all.
All right, I would say operational matters ought not to be discussed here. Operational matters, that is not our business. There's a National Security Committee, and even when they come into these matters, the committee could decide if you want to hear these things in camera. We are not here dealing with operational matters. So I think that must be made abundantly clear. But I think what the member for Digo Martin West is asking is, he's asking, for instance. Yes. Yes.
I am not aware that I made any requests here for any operational details. And I'm not aware that the National Security Council is anything other than an administrative body. And in 2010, whatever the National Security Council's terms of reference were in 2010, it is my view it remains the same now, the National Security Council, which is a coordinating body of our operational arms, chaired by the Prime Minister. Whatever they were doing in 2010, it cost this country $55 million. That's a fact. Then whatever they did or intended to do, and I never asked any details about it. So to make reference to glib statements, I understand glib to mean something else, besides other of my colleagues' interpretation. They intended to do something or things in 2014, and they budgeted $116 million. They have now revised that budget downwards to $80 million. And I'm saying I will be guided by that going forward. And it is now $90 million for 2015. And what I expected was an explanation as to what is driving this growth, rather than talking about scoring political points. Because we are here examining the budget. And if it is not to be examined here, then don't put it here and don't bring it here.
Yes. Yes, Prime Minister.
I have taken note of what the Honourable Member has suggested, Chair.
And having taken note, Mr. Chairman, without exposing the state's national security apparatus and endangering the state, would the Office of the Prime Minister explain to us this growth in the National Security Council, which, as far as we are concerned, is an administrative coordinating body? Is it increase in staff? increasing equipment, payment to foreign agencies, that is not going to breach national security. It will simply tell us where the growth is taking place. Is that too much for the parliament to ask?
Chair, we have had to deal with the prisons, grabbers and jammers, yes, baggage, screening, equipment. We have to deal with the Defense Force, Strategic Services Agency. Right now there is a campaign dealing with criminal gangs and so on. And these matters, I'm advised, are essentially responsible for the kind of numbers that you see us putting forward.
Right, we cannot spend all day on one matter.
I agree. Okay. I only have a few things in the Prime Minister's, the whole head, to ask. This was one of them. Are you saying that the Prime Minister's office, through the National Security Council, is handling some law enforcement issues? How would you say? Or some expenses that would naturally be attributed to law enforcement?
The Minister of National Security would assist with that.
Okay. Chairman, the National Security Council is indeed, quite rightly so, it is an administrative body, but they are also used as a conduit towards the acquisition of very technical and highly sophisticated equipment for the Ministry of National Security. And I'll give you a simple example. The Verin system, in May 2010, four days before the election, the Verin system was actually approved by the National Security Council at the cost of $100 million. So the National Security Council is indeed used as a conduit towards the acquisition of specific national security assets. What we can't do, Prime Minister, is that you can't get a comprehensive breakdown of the administrative costs and the operational costs. And the operational costs will very well include things such as the jammers and grabbers and intelligence aspects. But we cannot, for obvious national security reasons, divulge the specifics of the equipment. I don't know if that will suffice.
That's all you were asking. That's what you were asking for. We're not asking for details of national security elements. We are not that irresponsible. This exercise is not for that. So if you'll provide us with that, we'll be very grateful.
All right, so we're going on to minor equipment.
Chairman, I have a question on this subhead.
Which subhead is that?
Goods and services.
Which item? Which
sub-item? The question is with respect to security services.
What number?
43. And the acting prime minister indicated earlier in response to a question that none of the expenditure here or the allocations here reflect costs associated with any location apart from St. Anne's or the physical office of the prime minister. I just want to be clear that with respect to this increase in expenditure on security services for the OPM, that none of that is associated with any location in South Trinidad or elsewhere. Well, I'm asking now. Can you just be clear with the committee on that?
Yeah, Prime Minister, will respond to that?
My response is no.
All right, let's go on to sub. Yes.
And that deals with subhead 37, janitorial services, whereby in 2013, we are looking at $281,000. In 2014, $200,000. But in 2015, we are looking at $1.2 million, an increase of $1 million. Can Prime Minister indicate exactly what that $1 million, what would cause that $1 million increase in January?
Honourable Prime Minister.
And?
Mm-hmm.
And also, if you can indicate which janitorial company is being used for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Chair, I am advised that contract came to an end, where? At 200,000.
And they was higher before they were on month to month.
They were on a month to month. Under 28, line 28, other contracted services. Yeah? And.
They get a contract, it's not under here.
Okay. So a new contract is budgeted for at 1,282,000. Yeah?
Oh, all right, let's go on to subhead three, minor equipment purchases, item one, general administration. 04, current transfer and subsidies. Item five, non-profit. Where are you?
Four.
You are where?
Four.
Yeah, so we deal with current transfer and subsidies. Item five, non-profit institution. Member for Degomate Northeast?
Yeah, I see a new item, religious organizations, $50 million. Could we get an explanation for that, please?
Honorable PM, the religious organization, I understand. Item five.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is representing the payment of grants to religious organizations.
So was it somewhere else before? Because there's no allocation for it before?
Well, I understand that it used to come under the Ministry of Ecclesiastical
Affairs.
No, services. There are no such ministry. There are no Ministry of Ecclesiastical anything. No, sir. That's not possible.
This is a new item.
Yes, it's a brand new item. Brand new. New. What's it for? And since you can't tell us now, could you give us a breakdown of how this estimate of 50 million was built up? So we could see, you know, how you arrive at 50 million. 10 million for the Mahasabha.
You're interested in the prayers.
Member for St. Joseph.
Thank you, Chair.
No, but, Mr. Speaker, is the Prime Minister giving
He taken notes of it and then he will respond. So we're going to St. Joseph.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So, Chair, we will get a breakdown of the $50 million. My follow-up question is, based on what the Prime Minister said, that these are grants, does any other office of any other ministry, in addition to this $50 million grant, give religious bodies any further grants?
Well, I could not answer that because that is not in the body of information.
I recognize the member for Lavadale East, Mova.
Mr. Prime Minister, Mr. Chairman, I would like to know if this was advertised.
What?
Concerning the grants to religious bodies. How was it distributed and was there some advertisement?
No, this is an estimate for a new item. For 2015.
No, it's not.
Yeah?
It is worse.
Well, I suspect that when religious bodies make requests and so on, they would be provided with.
Well, I understand that grants, there are some churches that have been receiving grants. So where was this coming from if this is a new item?
Member for St. Joseph?
This is the first time that we are budgeting for this issue, right? I am aware that a number of religious bodies, you know, for their particular festivity and so on, have been in receipt of contributions from the government. Now, this is an attempt to formalize that whole thing going forward.
Lovely.
Member for St. Joseph.
Thank you. Thank you, Prime Minister, for that explanation. Based on your explanation, what is the policy position now? What policy position have you adopted so that when a religious body comes for part of this grant, they are told how to apply, what are the criteria? So when you are giving us the list of the breakdown, could you also tell us the policy decision driving this new initiative?
Yes, certainly.
All right, we go on to item nine, other transfers. I recognize Diego Martin Central, Aruka Maloney.
Two questions.
Shogunas West, 0.410. Which one you had asked for?
Under current questions, current transfers, we were on religious organizations, and I just wanted a clarification. So that the amounts that were given to constituencies when asked to religious bodies of 5,000 per constituency, per church, and for at Christmas, and then at Diwali and so on, under what head were those done?
I can't.
For 2014.
I don't think that would be followed on the OPM.
For 2014. It's a valid.
Yeah, but that is not on the OPM. That is not before us.
It is on the OPM that I've gotten those funds.
You got it from OPM?
That's what I'm saying. Yes, for 2014 and 2013.
Yeah.
What's your crime? Are you sure that
that's
for the... No. I'm telling you, I've picked it up myself under OPM.
Okay.
I'm not crying, but I'm just asking you, both for 2013 and 2014, where have these, under what head have these sums been extracted?
Please.
No answer.
That matter will be. Could you take note of that particular and respond? The member for the Gomartin Central, Aruka Maloney and Shogunas West.
I'm not hearing properly.
I wrote the people and I got.
Yeah, member for the Gomartin Central?
Yes. Chairman, with respect to the Divine Echoes Orchestra 08, there was no expenditure.
Please, member.
Chairman? Yes. There was no expenditure in 2014 after that group was disbanded. Previously, and I'm seeing an estimate of 60,000 for 2015. I'd like some detail on that, an explanation. Secondly, with respect to the National Association of Administrative Professionals, there was a projection of 1 million in 2014, which was not expended, and I'm seeing it back here again as a request for $1 million. With respect to that NGO, I am informed that there's an NGO unit within the government service. So why is the Office of the Prime Minister seeking this allocation of $1 million for 2015?
All right, Prime Minister.
Yes, with regard to the $60,000, it is an ex gratia payment to a former member of the band Divine Echoes, and this is now being budgeted for. Yeah? And with regard to National Association of Administrative Professionals, this is a commitment, I think. Yes? A grant towards the building of their headquarters.
Loni and then Shogunas West.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to give way to the opposition leader, please.
Yeah, well, go to Shogunas West, please.
And, could you give me some elaboration on how the figure was arrived at for the National Operations Center? 355 million? How was it arrived at?
Where are we?
Page 657, 009,
oh, yeah. Yeah.
Line item 10.
Item 10.
Okay. Yeah, on the other transfers? Yes, the Minister of National Security.
Sorry, Chairman, what was the question again?
I was asking, can you advise me how the figure of 355 million sure. was arrived at?
Okay. Yes, Chairman, the National Operations Center, that is a communicational backbone. So the system for the National Operations Center involves a very heavy IT system. It involves technical ability and the capacities where real-time video footage, information, intelligence gathering will all be fed into one specific area. So a team was actually appointed to look at the requirements for Trinidad and Tobago for such a center. And it varied. In the United States, for example, their system for a national operations center dealt specifically with operations. Pardon? Yes, and that was incorrect. So Trinidad and Tobago did not require that, because that was based on operations and the national. That's what, if you recall, initially it was a national security operations center. And based on the understanding we've seen from international best practice and similar to United Kingdom, where they have the cabinet officers briefing room, you use the National Operations Center as a system that is used for joint collaboration and communication between the different arms of the law enforcement agencies. Hence the reason why it was placed under the National Security Council, which happens to be under the Office of the Prime Minister. So the cost for a system like this, it really, as I said, it's a communicational backbone where it will involve a lot of technical aspects, IT. So it's not just a system of security cameras and televisions. It involves collaboration and information being fed, and it will include systems from the cameras from the law enforcement officers being fed immediately, the cameras on the from the Coast Guard vessel, the radar, the UAVs, everything being fed to one agency, into one system. And the cost for this will vary between, we've seen different costs vary between $500 to $700 to $800 million. So hence the reason for this. This will actually be over a 2-year period. So. But this year will be the initial cuts to actually get the whole system up and running, and then after there, it will improve further probably in 2015, 2016.
Is this center housed in its own building?
It is situated at the Knowsley building.
All right, we are moving on. Mr. Chairman, before we move on,
yes.
I did want to make a comment to the minister. Prime Minister, who spoke about this ex-gratia payment for the member of the band. I seem to recall that Divine Echoes was a band, a group of persons. How did the Prime Minister determine that one member of the band deserved an ex-gratia payment? And was there any consideration for the rest of the band? Why this member getting an ex-gratia payment? What are the circumstances?
Prime Minister?
I'm advised, sir, that the other members, because of the conditions of their employment, they received gratuity. This particular one, again, because of the conditions of his employment, did not get gratuity, so an ex gratia payment was advanced.
Okay, we are now going on to subhead 09, Development Program. Item 3, Economic Infrastructure. Member for the Gumate Northeast. Infrastructure Development Fund, Gangam, you can raise that here. Yes, of course.
Okay, on page 238, 1306F, public buildings, I see that no funds have been allocated for the restoration of Stallmeyer's Castle or Whitehall. And grass is growing out of Whitehall as we speak. So why is there no money for the restoration of Whitehall and Stallmeyer's Castle when there's a big sign up outside Whitehall saying, restoration work in progress?
Prime Minister, where? There's that another. I think there's I don't know. Is that still on the Prime Minister's?
Okay. No.
Prime Minister, go
ahead. I'm advised that we have nothing in that regard.
So you're not refurbishing Whitehall and Solmayer's Castle in 2015. You're leaving the grass to grow out of the window.
No, I think that will come under another ministry.
Oh,
yes?
No.
Apparently, I see the Minister of Social Integration and National Diversity waving his hands. So I got the impression that it is now under your ministry. So when it comes to his ministry, you'll be able to respond.
I looked there.
Let us go on to item 5, multisectorial and other services.
No.
Yes?
Is the Prime Minister saying that it should be dealt with elsewhere? Or should have been dealt with somewhere in the estimates. That's what you say. Okay.
Okay, honourable members, the question is that the sum of 638 million $708,600 for head 13, the office of the Prime Minister, stand part of the schedule. Those in favour, say aye.
Aye.
Those against say no. I think the ayes have it. The sum of 638,708,600 for Head 13, the Office of the Prime Minister, now stands part of the schedule. May I say that all the undertakings that the Prime Minister and his accounting officer have given have been duly noted. You'll be communicated, and you are expected to supply those responses before the end of the five-day period when we are supposed to end our exercise. Okay, thank you very much. We now proceed to Head 48, Ministry of Trade, Industry, Investment, and Communication.